Church, and in a very particular way, to alter Christus, to exercise is the result of sin. Fear is the result of the unknown. Fear is the lack of trusting in the mercy of God. And so, obviously, in ministry, there is a desolation. For the past 4, 6, 8 years of your formation, how often maybe were you challenged in that desolation to stay in fear in the upper room, to not come out of it? That fear will challenge us in our ministry. In your ministry, you're going to be challenged with a fear that says, I just want to stay here. I don't know what's going on. Remember, from time to time that happened in your formation, where fear paralyzed you and crippled you. I don't want to keep going forward. I don't know what celibacy is going to be. I don't know what obedience is going to be. I don't know what the leadership of the church is going to look like. And then there was the trauma of indecisiveness. Now that you men have been ordained and now entering into the order of presbyter, that fear cannot hold the church back. Do not be afraid. The message that our Lord so often said to the apostles, particularly to St. Peter. And so our third lesson, despite the locked doors, despite the fear, despite the trauma, by sheer grace and mercy, grace invades into the fear through locked doors. He breaks into that upper room by sheer grace. Remember when, in your formation at some point, being locked into fear, what did that grace tangibly feel like in your prayer? When by grace alone, nothing you can do, God chose to break into that locked room of your heart. Remember that. Don't ever forget that. Was it an external reality? Was it an internal reality? What was it that held you back, and then by sheer grace, God just burst into your heart? O come, Emmanuel, now that you're ordained and soon to be ordained as priests, be very intentional about calling him into that locked door of your heart. Come into my darkness, come into my fear, don't wait for him. Call him into it. That is a deep spiritual lesson. Now, those men gathered in that upper room were waiting, and God did not want to wait any longer. That's sheer gift. That's mercy. That's a divine mercy that can come to us. But now, don't wait for it. Call him into it regularly. The fourth spiritual lesson, before he even speaks to them, he shows them his hands and his side. He will now always bear the wounds. And while he'll take nothing from the old order into the new order, only that which is good, true, and beautiful, the truth, but the wounds stay. And those wounds were born by our sins, our hatred, our self-absorption, our fear, our pride, our injustice. See, the resurrection does not block out Good Friday. It doesn't erase it. And we are still in the old order. So when Christ, before he says anything, shows them his hands and his side, he wasn't doing it to make them feel bad. He wasn't doing it for guilt. This is how much I love you. And so you men, and for all of us, you're ordained into his personhood, not just one part of him, not just the baby Jesus, not just the teenage Jesus, not just the preacher Jesus, not just the resurrected Jesus. Totus Christus, the whole Jesus, including those wounds. Oh, there may have been a temptation that your formation may make for all of us, where we didn't want the wounds of formation. We didn't want that Good Friday. We did not want that type of woundedness to come into our lives, because formation will bring that into our lives, only to purify it. That's redemptive suffering. A formation that has no suffering cannot be redemptive. A priesthood, a priestly ministry that does not have the wounds of Christ will be mediocre at best. It was from those wounds that purity and salvation heals. We all know St. Teresa of Avila had frequent visions of the risen Christ. And one time the devil appeared to her as the risen Christ, and before anything could happen, she said, "Be gone, be gone, go." And the devil said, "How did you know? Because you didn't have the wounds See, the risen Christ, those wounds were a sign of a redemptive, of purity that is there. So a priesthood that goes through an assignment of skirting and ducking and trying to avoid the cross, that's not a spiritual father. Maybe you harken back to the words. What father among you would give his son a snake when he asks for an egg? A bad one. One that causes scandal. And so the Christian life here at Notre Dame Seminary of Formation has been teaching us to embrace the cross, grab onto it, overlooking wounds, and to bring those with you as a sign of how God was purifying you. And so part of the Christian life for you men is to bring the wounds of your seminary formation, not out of pessimism, cynicism, the best view of the seminary is the rearview mirror. This is Our Lady's house. We would never treat her like that. You'll bring those wounds from here to be able to understand the man and the priest that God has always wanted you to be. Then, lesson five, shalom, peace be with you. Now, they abandoned him, they denied him. Thomas isn't even there the first time. And that's the first thing he says, because the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He understands the fear, he understands the trauma, but shalom, that sums up what God's desires for each one of us. Peace. I'm not going to keep you in your trauma. I'm not going to keep you in your fear. By sheer grace, God's mercy, that shalom comes before us. The murdered God stands before them and says, shalom. Even killing God can't prevent the mercy. And so for us as a church, the ordained, particularly for the 12 of you entering into priesthood, if a murdered God can stand before those who denied him and cheated him, a Catholic priest will never judge, ostracize, alienate, ignore, or walk away from that woman who killed her unborn child. That gay couple in a same-sex marriage, the pro-abortion Catholic politician, Catholics who want women priests, if the murdered God can say shalom, so can we. Number six, the spiritual lesson. He breathes on them. In Genesis, the Ruach, I'm saying that wrong, the Hebrew, in Genesis, the Ruach, where God's breath is hovering over the waters, and over those waters comes a new creation. That's the same Hebrew word being used here. He breathes on them, Spiritus Sanctus. That Holy Spirit on those apostles and those disciples begins a sign of a new creation. And so the very prison that the bishop, as a successor to those apostles, breathed upon in the cathedral, will anoint you and consecrate and to bring you and to bring Christ into that new creation. It's a reminder that our ministry does not belong to us. It belongs to him, Christ. The seventh spiritual lesson. My goodness, whenever you first heard the call, when people were praying for you, and you might not have known, then you heard, come, follow me. Come to me, who are weary. Come, and you will be fishers of men. Come, stay with me. Now, the church is saying, go. Go make disciples. Go baptize all nations. I now send you. Fulton Sheen once said, that's what the church does. Between the come and the go. Very particularly, we're constantly being called. Ordination doesn't end the call. In some ways, it's just the very beginning. Come. Come follow me. Keep following me. I'm the good shepherd, not you. And as we keep coming to him, he also keeps saying, now go. Make disciples of these people that I have sent you to. The coming and the goings. The Spirit of Sanctus that's hovering over each of us, particularly upon the church's priests. This is our mission. This is the reason for Notre Dame Seminary. But now the eighth spiritual lesson, maybe the most difficult one of all, considering today's culture and society of individualism, self-preference. We think about ourselves first. Thomas wasn't there. Wherever Peter is, even huddled in an upper room, that's where the church was. The very upper room where the institution of the Eucharist. The very upper room in which the priesthood was established. Peter And so no wonder his reaction when he's told about what happened, until I see, until I touch. Who once said that before? Was Adam and Eve? They want that divine life. And God wants to give it to us. It's not ours to take. It's not ours to take. So divine mercy, you want it, Thomas? Here, I offer it to you. So the spiritual lesson for us is the ordained of the 12 of you, don't ever separate yourselves from the church, from your bishop, from the presbyterate. The division talks of the times, huh? The sign of confusion is the sign of the evil one. It can begin in our hearts. It can begin with us judging brother priests. It can begin with my definition of church over that of everybody else. And that's where Satan begins to use this. A divine mercy of sheer grace, Thomas is brought right back into the church, right back into that upper room, the Lord that allows with gift to give and for him to take. Those are the eight spiritual lessons. And on this great Divine Mercy Sunday, the church rejoices that the 12 of you have said yes, the 12 of you with whatever sufferings you've gone through, spiritual, physical, you keep still saying yes. Your class was a lot larger in T1, and now we have the 12 of you here. And I said to the T3 class, I'll be meeting with you all on Tuesday, not to end on a pessimistic note. But I've been standing here for 10 years, and the math is working against you. In 10 years, more than 10 priests have left the priesthood. In my 10 years, the math is working against you. So be a presbyter amongst yourselves as you go back to your diocese, and don't let the enemy do anything to trick you. Pray over those eight spiritual lessons, and God's mercy and grace will always be with you. He wants that for you. But how often do we just want to keep the door closed? Out of selfishness, out of fear and pride. Knowing the 12 of you now, I know with great confidence, my conscience is clear when I sign your testimonial, that you men are ready now to be ordained as presbyters for God's church. Take that gift. It's a mystery. It's a gift. Live it boldly. God's people.